The heaven and the earth are standing at his disposal. Finally, he calls you out of the earth, one call whereupon you immediately rise. To him belongs everyone in the heaven and the earth. All are subservient to him. And he is the one who initiates the creation, then repeats it. This is the easiest thing for him. And to him belongs the most sublime similitude in the heavens and the earth. And he is the Almighty, most wise. Absurdity of idolatry. He cites for you herein an example from among yourselves. Do you ever elevate your servants or subordinates to the level where they rival you, and to the point that you pay them as much allegiance as is being paid to you? We thus explain the revelations for the people who understand. Indeed, the transgressors have followed their own opinions without knowledge. Thus, who can guide those who have been sent astray by God? No one can help them. Monotheism is natural instinct. Therefore, you shall devote yourselves to the religion of strict monotheism. Such is the natural instinct placed into the people by God. Such creation of God will never change. This is the perfect religion that most people do not know. You shall submit to him, reverence him, observe the contact, prayer, salat, and do not be among the idol worshippers. Do not be among those who divide their religion into sects, each party rejoicing with what they have. Footnote 30 says, recognizing God alone as our Lord and Master is a natural instinct. We are born into this world with such an instinct, as shown in 7:172 and Appendix 7. How do you like that? Just every page of the Quran says God alone, God alone, God alone. So there is no excuse for doing any other way. It's amazing how much, how hard they work to go to hell. When they try every trick in the book to associate others with God. And will, they're just tricks. There's endless number of tricks to have them associate Muhammad or Hussein or Jesus with God. But here the first verse is, among his signs is that the heavens and the earth are standing at his disposal. Finally, he calls you out of the earth, one call, whereupon you immediately rise. When we rise on that day, we're going to know everything. We will go our initial blasphemy. We will know that we were sent to the earth for more schooling, to learn. That we were back into God's kingdom. And we know that only He is King. That only He is capable of being a God. When Satan thought that he can be a God besides God, it was not just arrogance or pride. He simply was wrong. It was not possible. And this demonstration that we're having today proves that. 26, to him belongs everyone in the heaven and the earth. We belong to him. And are subservient to him. God created us. We are God's creatures. He owns us. And we are indeed fortunate that he is the Rahman al-Rahim, the most gracious, most merciful. Because we are his creatures, when the other creatures said, send them all to hell, God said, no, I'll give him another chance. This is the ultimate love. When here are creatures who are blaspheming against him, and God said, I will send them back to be redeemed. And actually God is accepting the flimsiest excuses to redeem us. Gives us 40 years. Look how many millions of people are going to the lower heaven instead of hell. Going to heaven instead of hell. How many millions who would have gone to hell because of the initial cry, but they're going to heaven instead?
All the God's mercy. Starving.
Yeah. Not only that. Look at, I use Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, people who almost made it to 40, but they're saved and sent to heaven instead. Had they lived, they he would have been swept into the Christianity wave.
The question that arose not too long ago in Vancouver is, if God is so merciful, why does he let children starve in Africa, for example? In fact, if you look at the situation very carefully, you'll find that they are dying out of his mercy. Because they're guaranteed. I would trade places with these kids anytime.
Well, that's only not only that, but it's also Satan's incompetence. They're victims. They're victims of Satan. Because whoever asked the question will not be satisfied. They're still suffering. They're still hungry. They're still, why suffer for 1 second, for example? But it is a demonstration of Satan's incompetence.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stepped in and corrected for Satan's incompetence by putting these kids in paradise.
What God does he assign? Why did he have to go through that? God is merciful. Why
demonstration
did
of
yeah.
The demonstration of Satan's incompetence.
Yes, that's a very important point.
So Satan doesn't really want us to go to heaven.
To heaven?
Because he's spent there, brother. He wants us to join him in hell.
Yeah.
So actually.
Actually, what Satan is doing now is we have to look at the total picture. What Satan wants to do now is prove that he was right, that he can have a perfect world or a perfect dominion, because he knows that the matter of heaven and hell is already decided. He knows that. But what he wants to prove is that he wants to tell God, "I'm right. I was right when I thought I have enough qualifications and enough power to run a dominion, and I didn't go far." But things get out of hand as the number of people increases. For example, why do we have AIDS now? Where was it 100 years ago? Where did it come from? AIDS. And you can see that the world is getting more, there's more progress, there is more convenience. We're sitting in air conditioning and fans. There's cars and planes and comfort, different kinds of luxuries. Okay, so he's been working to please the he's really working to make the human beings enjoy and have a perfect health, perfect wealth, perfect systems, economic systems, and so on. He's been doing this. But the population is increasing, the human beings, and things are getting out of hand. Beyond his capacity. And there are experiments that are going on to prove that he's not omnipotent or omniscient, for example. And the miracle of the Quran is a perfect example. This miracle came out, some of you may be shocked who didn't hear it before, but this miracle came out of the biggest brewery in the whole world, the biggest alcohol manufacturing place in the whole world. Do you know that?
This miracle
of the Quran.
Because you were working
Yes.
I thought you were working for Monsanto.
Yes, I was working for Monsanto enough to learn the computer programming and to use the computers, computerize the chemical research. And then I took the data, all the papers, and I moved on to Anheuser-Busch. I was giving a paper in Chicago. There was the American Chemical Society meeting in Chicago. And I was giving a paper, and after I finished, there comes this man, and he says, "I'm Bob Seeley, I'm director of research at Anheuser-Busch."
Seeley?
Yes, Bob Seeley.
S-E-E-L-E-Y.
I'm Bob Seeley, director of research at Anheuser-Busch, and I would like you to come and work with us. I said, "Sorry, there's no way." I left. He said, "Why?" I said, "I'm a Muslim, and we don't believe in alcohol, and I don't think I want to have anything to do with it." He said, "This has nothing to do with alcohol." I said, "Well, still, but the name Anheuser-Busch, I don't want my name on a card with Anheuser-Busch on the same card." He said, "You're going to be in the food research division. You're a protein biochemist, and we want to get protein out of the millions of tons of brewer's yeast that we throw away, and baker's yeast. They also make baker's yeast. We're throwing these millions of tons of protein. As you know, yeast is 50% protein. 50% protein, which is true. And we would like to recover all this protein and process it into artificial eggs, meat, whatever. It's protein. Protein is protein is protein. Meat, eggs, beans.
It's all the same.
It's all protein, same stuff, and we're throwing it down the drain." I said, "Sorry, there's no way I'll do that." And he said, Are you afraid of the people or afraid of God? You know, you got into this kind of thing. And I said, I'm happy at Monsanto. I don't want to change. He said, how much are you making at Monsanto? I said, 14,000. That was a lot of money then. He said, we'll give you 22,000. I said, what do I sign? It's been all this long argument, I could have told you for the first. Huh? Really what? Yes. Yes. Then I went, I moved, it's the same town. Except I had to drive on the freeway for 20 more minutes. So.
For $7,000 more, you wasn't right. That deal.
So I moved on to Anheuser-Busch. And I tell you, today, they have a whole building called Research and Development. A huge building, beautiful laboratories and so on. But when I was hired there, he told me we're going to have a new research building. But I never got to that. But so my office was in the brewery, the biggest brewery in the world, which is making alcohol. And so I took all this data into my office. And to go further, show you how miraculous it is, one of the biggest problems with yeast was to break the wall of the cell wall to get the protein out. So this is the cell wall. You have to break it to get the protein out. And that was a problem for 150 years since they started research on the yeast to get the protein out. But right now I have a patented process for the benefit of Anheuser-Busch of breaking the wall and getting the protein out.
But you developed it.
I developed
it
and I patented it.
That the fact that what you are doing, you are actually trying to perfect the system of Satan. Because
no, I did.
May I
yes, go
finish
ahead.
My line of thought?
Mm-hmm.
Because you didn't want to work with alcohol. And then he said, but you will take the product that comes out of alcohol production and use it for the benefit of mankind.
Right, exactly. This is one line that he told me.
What I'm trying to say is that the system of Satan is incompetent.
Yes.
And there was a byproduct. But imagine if you had used all these yeast and proteins without making any alcohol at all, but using it all for proteins. What you are doing, you are actually supporting the manufacture of alcohol by upgrading.
I see your point. I see what you mean.
Well,
Sealy showed me an article,
yeah.
A United Nations report, that there will be famine in Egypt by 1975. And he said, you don't want to be an active participant in eliminating famine. It was one
Egypt.
Of the lines.
No.
It doesn't have
Egypt. Never.
So I took all this data. Now, the reason I'm mentioning the breaking the cell wall is that the process was to put the yeast, mix it with potassium hydroxide, and for 4 hours, have it heating for 4 hours. This is how you break that. So what do I do for 4 hours? So I go in the morning, take the yeast, put it in a big beaker, put sodium hydroxide, and let it cook for 4 hours. What do I do now?
Read books.
So first of all, this made them very happy. It was a breakthrough. Second of all, it gave me 4 hours, you know, from 8 to noon, in order to look at the data and analyze it and confirm the count of the letters. And I was working on the miracle for 4 years.
Allah,
so the whole miracle came out of Anheuser-Busch.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Now the point before I forget is that if we pray, if we play, this is something we used to do. Play a game where we hide a little ball, for example. Play a game. One of us will go and hide it in a place and we'll go looking for it, and when it gets hot, we'll play faster or slower. It's a game like that. And one of us will get out and look, and we'll all clap, it's hot or cool, you know, that game. So the best way to hide the ball will be in the person's pocket.
Right.
It's the last thing he will look at. So what is God hid the miracle in Satan's pocket. And this is how it came out. Because why was it 1400 years? Satan will do his utmost, as you know, to hide this. Not to let the world know. You understand the point now?
But Satan paid.
So Satan is not omniscient, is he? Because Satan, looking at the planet Earth, and he wants to find the people to mislead. He says, this is Masjid Tusa, and I better go and mislead those people. And he sees the brewery and says, oh no, those are mine, those are in my pocket, let me find another place.
These are my guys.
Yes.
But you know, Rashad, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the yeast cell, he created it for this discovery.
Yes, for that design. Why didn't anybody think of potassium hydroxide? They used sodium hydroxide hydrolysis. The thing they concluded from that potassium hydroxide would not work. Sodium and potassium are very similar. They tried acids, all kinds of acids, and they didn't work. But potassium hydroxide worked.
Why did you think of that?
I don't know.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
I think I read all the literature and I found that they used all these, but not potassium hydroxide. I said, let me try it. Sure enough, the cell was broken and the protein came out.
Pardon?
Well, yes, of course.
What is it?
I don't know. I have to look up the table.
What is 19? Chemical.
57 is 56 is iron, but one of the isomers is 57, and Sura 57 is iron. There's a whole book on that. Satan's omniscience is eliminated because of this. This is the biggest defeat for Satan. This mathematical miracle of the Quran is something that he worked very hard to prevent, but it came out of his pocket.
But he wasn't even aware of it. He didn't know it.
Sure.
Yes, he did.
He did.
It's Baha'ism.
He established Baha'ism. It's easy for him to know that. It's very easy for him to know that. Satan probably knew, in that other dimension, Satan probably knows that all God's creation has the 19 on it. And then he reads in the Quran, on it are 19. So he's not stupid, by no means. He's very stupid, I'm sorry, but I mean, the relative.
He's sly.
He's very, he's very stupid for thinking that he can be a God.
But he has a lot of knowledge.
Yes.
Knowledge,
of course. I mean, he's just overestimating his powers. And God did not give him, actually God is giving him another chance to prove that. But he knows better than making such a claim.
So the fact that for instance,
there are many, many, many millions of creatures like Satan in God's kingdom. But he's the only one who went off.
The fact that 20,000 children are dying every day in the world of starvation actually makes Satan really annoyed.
Yes.
Because it proves every day that
proves
he is
incompetence.
Really incompetent.
Exactly. But again, back to God's mercy, to give us 40 years is really giving us the flimsiest excuses to save us, redeem us, take us to heaven. The people who live beyond 40 and then fight God had to be very, very bad as far as that blasphemy was concerned. So if any of us had an atom of leaning towards God during that big feud, God apparently is saving all those people. And there are millions, and they will be so thankful in the hereafter.
Rashad, excuse me, what would be
Satan's punishment? Exile from God's kingdom.
Rashad, I mean,
he's made of fire himself. So, yes. I mean, hell wouldn't hurt him.
Hell is not fire.
It's not fire.
See, remember hell and heaven are allegory.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Who?
It's
1:30. The plane leaves at what time?
2:30, yeah.
You have 1 hour. See, another good surprise. Where's Parivash? Go kiss him.
I didn't even know.
Yes.
Yes.
Let's listen to Feruza's question. What did you say?
Isn't there a verse in Quran that says the devils are prevented from understanding Quran?
On this dimension. In this dimension.
For example, the jinns, they don't know because when they heard Moses,
yes.
سمعنا القرآن
العجيب. They don't know the Quran, right?
يهدي للرشد.
Oh, this is exactly the example I was looking for. We were talking this morning, is it the same people who were talking about how when the Prophet Muhammad said, say,
I'm afraid if I disobey my Lord, I'm afraid of the terrible retribution. How many people
the
are
retribution of a terrible day.
And I was looking for an example where qul, say, means it is done. So, the verses say, I was inspired that a number of jinns listened to the Quran and they went to the people. So this is something that I was involved in. This is a good example. It was already done. I didn't need qul, say, I was inspired to say that a number of jinns listened to the Quran and that was already done. So I was saying that when the Prophet Muhammad was ordered to say, I'm afraid if I disobey my Lord, Muhammad, was you? Remember you asked the question if Muhammad's property belonged to the state or to his children and there was fight. And I told you, you will not find anything that Muhammad took for himself. And I was positive about that because of that verse. He will see to it that nothing entered his pocket that was not belonging to him, that was belonged to the state. Or
that he was not entitled to.
Right, exactly. Because Muhammad was telling me a hadith and sunnah story that after the Prophet died, they were fighting over who inherits his property. Is it the state or his children?
Not all of his property, Rashad. It was only certain property.
No, none of it. None of it. He did not have any property that was not his.
But the fight was specifically over that.
There was no fight. See, we must learn not to take off on a hadith story or something. You cannot make an assumption. Somebody says this is red, and then you go on discussing why it is red, because the assumption is that it is wrong. Muhammad.
Yeah, you said hell is not fire. Yeah. What is hell?
Hell is exile from God and not having. First of all, we have no way of comprehending what heaven is and what hell is.
Hell is hate and heaven is love.
Hell is exile from God. It's exile that is farther from this earth. Wake up. We're not going to sleep.
No, I'm listening to what you're saying that hell is exile.
Listen to this carefully. We are here in the seventh universe. In the heart of the seventh universe. And you can see how many problems the people have. Alcoholism, accidents, divorce, miseries. There will be an eighth universe. On the day of judgment, the eighth universe will be hell. Can you imagine how far it will be? This is why God says, we're going to fold the heavens and the earth like the folding of a book. And then in Surah 14, God says, I will create new heavens and new earth. And this time there will be eight of them, not seven. They'll probably be much bigger. And the eighth universe will be much farther from God. So that's hell. It will be much worse. We have no way of comprehending how bad it is. See, even in this seventh universe, God is taking care of all the provisions, providing for all the ants and the horses and the people. But in the eighth universe, there is no such thing. The people will be in the new form of butterflies instead of caterpillars. There'll be different kinds of, and they will try to come to the seventh universe.
That means that the people who are going to hell, instead of going up, they falling down.
Yes, father, yes. Yes, exactly.
So, Rashad, what's the meaning when in the Quran says that you will be the ones who are in hell, you will be burned and then reburn again.
And then reburn again.
What does that mean?
So, allegorical. All the descriptions of hell and heaven in the Quran are allegorical, all of them. But you get glimpses of what it is like in Surah 57, when the hypocrites come and try to beg for light. This means energy. Go take a nap. Come on, go.
It's more like in a sense, nothing new, but like angels that travel from the higher universes, they travel all the way down here. And the Quran says that the believers will go down and meet
people. We'll go visit our friends and relatives in hell.
Yes. Most people you know.
Yes. Yes. It's going to be fantastic. That day of this eternal day of the real life is going to be fantastic. Everything.
And
you're walking around now as a king or queen on earth, but nobody knows you, which is wonderful because you don't need secret service guards. We go to the subway in Washington, D.C., walking among the people. There are actually gods and everything. Sometimes it happens literally, like with Ahsan. She was going to Africa, Sierra Leone. I told her they will, so the Amiratul Umara, you know, servant of God and a princess, and they will meet you with the red carpets and 21 guns and gun salute and the lines of soldiers and so on. And soon enough, she went to Africa, they landed, and there's the red carpet and the 21 gun salute and the soldiers in line. And they thought they were meeting the president of Gambia, you know, who was on the same plane with her. She told the you tell him your granddaughter is a college student?
Yes.
She's a college student and they and she probably thought that I'm just thinking highly of you.
Yes, I thought, see how nice you are, so how highly you think of me, how Jesus Christ is it. And after a while, from London, here comes a lot of people, promotion, almost checking everybody, see behind the chair, and then, say, what's happening? I say, is the IP in the game?
That's right. we know.
The
but you didn't say what Sunaita said. So they're landing, imagine her granddaughter, they're landing and there's the red carpet and the 21 gun salute, the things that we said. She thought, say, Grandma, Grandma, they are doing it.
And Rashad gave them the
phone. Right.
Yeah.
This is what you said? Oh, yeah. Yes, Muhammad.
Yes, Rashad. Surah 104, it says here in Arabic, وَأَمَّا مَنْ حَافَتْ مَوَازِنُهُ وَأُمُّهُ هَاوِيَ وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا هِيَ
نَارٌ حَامِيَ. Yes.
That is نَارٌ.
Yes.
And جَحِيمٌ.
Yes.
And in Surah 102, it says, yes. لَتَرْعُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ.
Yes.
Which is translated here, you will perish in hell.
Yes.
And this, the blazing hell fire.
Yes. It's all allegorical, all of it. So you see, the first, at the very beginning of the Quran, when God talked about heaven and hell, He told us this is allegorical. Yeah, they're all allegorical. There's no, it's not fire. It's mostly darkness, actually. Mostly dark. Remember, we need some of your light.
Is it spiritual darkness or actually physical darkness?
Both.
Both, everything.
Yes. Well, because the 8th universe, God will not give him stars or anything.
Yeah, and it's just a proof that if Shaitan is from fire and hell is fire,
yeah.
It doesn't have to.
He'll enjoy it, no, it'll be a little provision. No, it's not fire at all, and heaven is not trees and spouses and food, fruit. Be indescribably fantastic.
Maybe hell will be very cold because so far no stars and
yes.
Shaitan, you know. Made of fire in the cold wind.
Exactly. Here we go. You see, we understand a lot from the understand. We have quite a bit of information, you know, in the Quran. When we learn that we can go and visit our relatives and friends, and they will be coming around us like butterflies go around the light. You know, imagine 1,000 acres of. Alfalfa, what is that? Clover? I was going to say clover. Alfalfa, for example, there's millions of butterflies, and it's pitch dark in that 1,000 acres, and then you send the light. Huh? What a ride. So, we will go there, and we're going to visit, and they will come, and they beg for light. And we will go and meet them, and we will talk to them, And I will say, thank God that I didn't listen to you.
Will we have any remorse?
Surah 37.
Will we have any
Never.
Remorse?
No. Because this is another point. Will we have any remorse? Will you feel sorry for them?
What is remorse?
Yes. Yes. We will not feel sorry for them. There will be no sorrow at all.
Even if they're good friends or relatives or whatever.
Even if they're the best of friends, because you realize they well deserved what they wanted, that they insisted on going there. I loved my father very much. He loved me very much all our lives. But I don't feel sorry for him, because he was fighting God actively. And he insisted on going to hell.
He wanted
it. Yeah, he wanted it bad. Because I talked to him here for 4 months in this message. And one of the times he stood outside the mosque. I'm not going in this masjid unless you add Muhammad to the adhan. Yeah. I said, then you cannot come in here because idol worshippers are filth. I have to use that expression from the Quran.
Subhanallah.
So this is idol worship. You're not satisfied with God alone. So I'm using the example of my own father because I really love him immensely. And I was his favorite for a long time until I said God alone.
إِنَّا الْمُشْرِكِينَ نَجَسُ.
Yes. I mean, he went to extremes. He went from loving me excessively to calling someone to have me put away, imprisoned or killed. Then he died 19 days later. Yes. So we will not feel sorry for them because they insisted on it. This is what they wanted. Oh, yes, you will. Yes, Umuhawiya. Yes, going down. Down, going down. Muhammad, did you hear this? Did you hear what?
No, I didn't hear
what. Parivash was saying that this means when the new universe is set up, the people heading for hell will go down to the 8th universe. And then right after that, you read the verse, فَأُمُهُ هَاوِيَةٌ. أُمُهُ, you know, is ahead of him, or whatever, his destiny is going down. Hawa means somebody who falls, like if somebody falls from a plane, or a rock falls from a plane, and this is Hawa, this is God goes down.
Hawa?
Yeah. Yahweh, for Allah.
Yani no support, actually.
Shading smile is there.
Yes, what about
it means lack of support.
Yahweh means
to fall down.
How about Taslana and Hamia?
Yes.
It's coming in
Ania. I understand that Muhammad is it is described as fire in here. And heaven is described as a garden. But we're told this is allegorical.
It's not to be allegorical, because had he been addressing Eskimos, he would have spoken of a frozen place.
Yes. I want to give you an example.
Yes,
it means it burned my... Yes,
it doesn't mean fire.
Exactly.
Also, Muhammad, he describes paradise as a place with flowing rivers and cool breezes. See, it's obviously it's not. It's much more than that.
Rivers of milk, honey, and wine.
The hotels in Hawaii look like paradise. That's just described. But obviously it's not.
Yes. Yes.
See, I remember seeing the appendix in the Golden Quran. It says just that our minds are not able to comprehend except by the level of our consciousness. So it gives us a picture that we can use to comprehend.
Yes.
And this sword being Romans, I notice, and I'm wondering, in the Bible of Romans, in chapter 1, verse 21, I think it is. Is a verse that says that man...
What an eye never saw.
that mankind has this condition whereby he cannot accept God unless he puts it in some kind of imagery, some kind of form.
Mm-hmm.
And now this is telling us about the idolization. Whether it's for idolatry or even for the believers to come to non-idolatry, we
yes.
have to have some picture, but it seems the motivation
I've been trying to avoid saying this, but I say it since we're all adults anyway. It's like a child, you just try to describe sexual orgasm to a child.
No, no, no.
How will you describe it? It's something that they will grow and it's ahead of them 20 years from now. So this is 6 or 7 year old.
There's no way you can understand it.
Right, right.
But in the socialist totalitarian dictatorship, they are teaching the children this.
Yeah,
but
there's no way you can understand it. You cannot.
How will they describe it?
But then they
How do you describe to a child who never experienced it?
I will tell you.
Right,
tell you.
Exactly.
Listen, I will tell you a horror story. Russia, with your permission.
Now we know how good Tom is.
I will tell you a true fact.
I'm sorry.
You know what they do in Sweden? In Sweden, there is a law. It says compulsory daycare for children from 18 months. So all the children are more or less forcibly put into state-controlled daycare centers from the age of 18 months. There are two books that the daycare personnel are supposed to use. Not all of them are using it because they understand that they are satanic. But some do. There's one book called The Love Life of Our Children, or Dawn and Shelley. In this book, the 18 to 20 year old daycare personnel, girls, okay, nobody's listening.
Well, see, I don't want to dwell on this subject too much.
I will just tell you how evil this state is.
Don't worry about it, it's the least of their problems. Do they worship God alone?
This
is the problem. There's one thing I wanted to say. Oh, I want to go back to what Eli said. When, like having 20 ice creams. Because the child loves ice cream. So you say, give him something that he or she can identify with as something that is very good. So God is telling us heaven is fruit and rivers of milk and honey and so on. Get? Exactly. Thank you, because this is what I just told the Eric. I said, I don't want to dwell on this. You see, Eric, this is a good demonstration of, when I remember I told you, we are not politicians. That's why, as soon as you mention politics, the group lose interest. They didn't do it on purpose to you. They're not being discourteous to you.
I understand.
But it's just that we're not interested in politics. We're interested in what God wants us to do. What is the dominant thing? I always tell my friends, this is the least of their problems. Do they worship God alone?
I just want to give an example of Satan. Yes. He's trying to overcome
this
by forcing in it.
Exactly. Yeah. But it's all over the place. Yes.
It's terrible.
Yes.
I mean,
exactly. Okay, let's go to the next verse. Number 27, and he is the one, there's only one, who initiates the creation. Remember Chester in his speech said, we cannot create the wing of a fly?
We won't create anything.
The wing of a fly, do you know how much weight that is? Do you know what it is made of?
Gasoline.
You know, if you look under the microscope, you can see those. It's built, it is designed, and it moves at 10,000 movements per minute. Yes.
Wow.
And it doesn't just move like this. I'm simplifying it. There's a
an angle.
There's
an
a specific
angle.
Movement. They did it in slow motion, and it's really
to make it fly. To make it fly, yeah.
You can write a book on the movement of the fly's wing and how it is designed. Now, what makes it, think of a number 8 that the wing is drawing. And did you try to chase fly with your all your abilities and you're trying to get, and you sneak up on the fly and you go very slowly and they have radar, see? Right.
It doesn't mean that when he takes sugar, it is integrated.
Yes, immediately, yes. As a matter of fact, it's on the spot. The mouth of the fly excretes enzymes that break up the sugar
before
to its components, the glucose and fructose. So the fly is absorbing either glucose or fructose. How are we going to bind them back together? Enzyme is a catalyst. Any enzyme is a catalyst. It breaks up chemicals in an unusual manner. It works on the chemical bonds between the two molecules, glucose and fructose. I'll send you a bill for this chemistry lesson. He is the one who initiates the creation, then repeats it. This is the easiest thing for him. And repeats it can mean here in this world, where you see Ilahi duplicated by Lillian. It's a repetition. There is Lillian all over, Ilahi all over again. Or repeats it means in the hereafter. This is the easiest thing for him.
The easiest means, yeah, Hina, he's using a figure of speech. It means that it's very, very, very easy for him. It does not represent any...
Yes.
But because you see, the creation of the universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, is more difficult than the creation of
exactly.
the... But since Allah creates by instructing, by saying, kun,
yes.
Kun a camel or kun a fly is the same.
Right.
It's a figure of speech, I think.
I think this is the time to address that blasphemy in the Bible, human blasphemy, where it says God created the heavens and the earth and then rested in the seventh and 6 days and then rested in the seventh day. We have the statement here in the Quran that says we created the heavens and the earth and I was not tired at all. He said no tiresome touched me, God says. It's in Surah 50. See if you can find it. It's very important to know this. God says it's the easiest thing for him.
وَلَا يَؤُدُوا حِفْظُهُمَا also in Surah Al-Baqarah.
No, this is running them.
Yeah.
But what about the creation itself? Yes.
And no fatigue. 50-38.
How about
50-38. No
fatigue. Yes. We're going to look up page 520, 520, verse 38. What's your new Quran? Oh. It says, we have created the heavens and the earth and everything between them in 6 days and no fatigue touched us.
So he didn't need to rest on the seventh.
Exactly. This particular verse, which happens to be 19 times 2, is a direct answer to the blasphemy of the writers of the Bible. They confound the truth with falsehood. Yes? Yes. Look at that. Yes. This is what this man just quoted, but this has to do with running the universe. The verse here that we're discussing, that it's the easiest thing for him, creation. It's the easiest thing. So directly related to it is 50:38. And it is a direct answer to that Bible writers.
Nice.
Okay, very good question. 6 days, although we'll go into another surah, but the whole purpose of this Quranic study is to understand. The 6 days a yardstick. 6 days has nothing to do with days. It's a yardstick, a measurement. Who's making the noise? When you hear noises, please look and see if your child is making the noise. It's your responsibility to keep it quiet. The 6 days is a yardstick. For example, we have this clock. It's a yardstick. We look at it and we say, the plane will leave in 1 hour. So we know what 1 hour is. It's a yardstick, 24 hours in the day. So God told us that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days.
But we learn also that he created the earth in 4 days. Even though the earth is a tiny, tiny mote, what does this tell us? There's a lot of information in this statement. What does this tell us if all these billions, trillions, decillions of heavenly bodies in their precise orbits were all created in 2 days, and this tiny, tiny mote earth was created in 4 days? What does this tell us? It tells us there is no life out there. As confirmed by our journeys to the whole solar system, Voyager went, we didn't see any creature on Neptune, or the moon or Mars. There's not a single tree out there. But here, all the horses need alfalfa and beans, barley. So every grain of barley had to be calculated, which horse is going to eat this. So this is why it took 4 days. The 6 days, therefore, is a yardstick, has nothing to do with days or years or whatever.
Again, I wish it's not a measure of time. Because, like I said, God says B and it's a camel, and B and it is a fly.
Yes.
It's the same thing. The process is the same.
I think a good demonstration is Moses' staff. B, a snake, and it was a snake on the spot. Just like that.
But
do I know about B and it is?
Yeah, that's right. But, could it not be a measure of the importance Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places on the test and on the human race?
No, it is also literal. When God says He created the earth in 4 days and the whole universe in 2 additional days, it is literal, relative to each other. Because there is a physical creation process, even if it is instantaneous.
But does it say that it was more difficult to create the heavens?
Yeah, yeah. The sunrise and Tucson, every day until the end of the world, indicates the preciseness. I mean, what is out there? There's nothing. There's space. Anything can go in any orbit, but it is not. There is a line. Can you imagine a line that the sun is moving in, and the earth is moving in, and the moon is moving in? The whole thing is moving. The earth around the sun, and the moon around the earth. Okay, the moon around the earth, and the both of them around the sun, and the sun around something else in the galaxy, and the whole galaxy around something else. It's very, very precise.
Suddenly, it's a little cloud over a little house out in the desert.
Exactly, and that was measured, yes. That rain fell on the dining hall of the one where we were meeting.
When we decided to change the schedule. Bang.
Yes. No, because Cecilia was there, and there was this frozen water came down. It's all Cecilia's fault. Confess. Yes.
Yes, dumb question, but do you think really that perhaps, like when the sun is going around, there's an angel really pushing it in accordance
with
the
sun? Yes, certainly. No. There's no angels pushing these
things. No. See, what happened was, we are living in the Big Bang right now. We are living right now in the Big Bang. Remember, God says that the universe is expanding?
Yes.
There is movement. Why is the earth hanging in space? What is it that's holding it in space?
Speed. The will of God.
Speed.
Right. It's like a bullet out of a gun. Between, let's say the bullet travels from here to that wall. Why is it hanging in space? Okay, let's stop everything. Okay, the bullet, you shoot a bullet from here to here. And as the bullet reaches this spot right here,
freeze everything.
Now, why is it hanging in space? Because of the power of explosion. Explosion from the gun. So the Big Bang theory, which is confirmed in the Quran, Surah 21, verse 30. Keep Hani away from Lillian. Then we'll go. So go sit with Dalia. The Big Bang theory is confirmed in the Quran and confirmed by our own theories. The Big Bang is like this. Okay? And there are pieces and shrapnel. Think of them as a bomb that exploded. And we are sitting in one of the shrapnel, and it's traveling in space. This is
actually,
what
we can hear the speed.
Yes.
If we listen.
So God's creation is controlling this. It's not an uncontrolled explosion.
Background radiation.
So all these shrapnels are moving according to laws, physical laws, that God already set in motion.
Created. If we can just expand this.
There's no angel holding the sun.
If we can just expand this for a moment. Magnets. You have a North Pole and a South Pole.
Yes.
Okay. How does the North Pole know that this guy is a South Pole and he should be pushed away? rather than another north, a north pole that should be pushed away, rather than a south pole that should be attracted. How does a sodium atom recognize that this is a hydroxide molecule and it should be attracted, rather than an iron atom that should be pushed away? How do they recognize
the electromagnetic forces? Electromagnetic forces.
I think it's
that we don't see. There are physical forces. For example, the sodium hydroxide, they click. There's a certain thing that they click perfectly into each other to form the salt. This is the physical thing. But there's also between them the electromagnetic forces that attract or repel, repulse.
Yeah, but how do they know? How does the electromagnetic, the thing, the mechanism that pushes or attracts?
Yes.
How does it know that this is to be?
Well, God set the laws for this.
So it's not angels who are doing it?
No, not angels, no. That would be very difficult to explain. To get an angel to have your exchange of food between your lungs and your blood and the oxygen. You know that when they breathe, the oxygen goes in there to oxidize food.
Right.
It's coming in the blood to the lung. The lung are little balloons, very little balloons with the blood vessels around them. And they take the oxygen, get out the carbon dioxide. There are billions of biochemical reactions going on.
Right.
You want an angel for every reaction?
Why not?
You'll have 2 billion angels inside your body. The angel can hold the whole earth in one hand. That's what the angels are. An angel can hold the whole planet earth in one hand. One angel. They're enormous creatures.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so guarding us.
Huh?
How are there two of them guarding us?
Or they are. Because they have the capacity of being here at the same time. Yes. Or not necessarily to shrink. They may be encompassing the whole earth, but they're watching you. Nobody else.
And when we say Rabbi a'udhu bika min Rabbi a'udhu bika min hamazat ash-shayatin wa a'udhu bika rabbi
an yahdhurun, comes a shaitan to bother you, out of here.
So an angel comes in,
yes,
to
keep away the devils, yeah, and his whisper.
Yeah.
I mean, literally, the devil come and whisper to you and will tell you you're interfering in your understanding of the Quran. But when you seek refuge in God, there are angels assigned to come and to keep those.
Whose job is?
Because we're talking about the whole other dimension. Invisible forces, invisible soldiers, the Quran always talks about them. So we're unaware of what is happening in the invisible direction. Also, in the invisible dimension, there is no time, for example.
That's right.
And there is no distance. So how will the angels, see, we think with our own dimension, how will they travel 190 billion light years in one day or in 5 minutes? Because the distance is zero and the time is zero, so they can travel in a second. Yes. Well, I don't want to go too deep into this.
Can I ask one question?
Question.
The reason I asked a seemingly dumb question about an angel pushing, the reason I'm saying it, because to us physically, logically, scientifically, appear certain things. But the same way, you know, the clouds.
Right, the angels push the clouds.
It says that the angels push them.
Right, the angels push the clouds, distribute provisions. This has to do with us. This is what the meaning of the angels falling prostrate before Adam, the human being.
Allah says that the angels push the clouds?
Yes, but they're here to them.
No.
Driving the winds also. And they use for or against people. God says that with the thunder and the lightning, He hits whomever He
hits. Yes, He sends them the lightning.
Yes.
You're still
God. Yes. The angels have lots of functions here on the planet Earth, mainly associated with us. Have to do with us.
I thought actually, you know.
No, not the thunder. This is the Big Bang explosion. This had laws that ruled that. The angels will not go in there and connect the atoms and the molecules and separate them. So full of laws. Electromagnetic laws between the atoms.
Is it possible that the reason for the cause of the Big Bang, because the Quran says that, you know, when they commit a blasphemy and say, like, three, for example, the heavens are about to burst, would it be that this original mass heard something else besides La La Illa La and the Big Bang?
Sure, why not?
I didn't understand.
The blasphemy of Satan. But this is a deliberate plan. Give us the test.
All of the purpose of all of this is to create the environment for the test.
Run the test, yes. First of the whole, the seven universes.
Only the manifest.
Number 28.
He
He cites for you herein an example from among yourselves. Do you ever elevate your servants or subordinates to the level where they rival you, and to the point that you pay them as much homage, allegiance, as is being paid to you? We thus explain the revelations for the people who understand. Okay, to make you understand this, they say Muhammad will intercede on the day of judgment. So let us put this in practice. The day of judgment comes, and here is a man who's interceding on behalf of the believers. So
let Hajj explain.
Yes, this is Ahsan's explanation. So Mr. Smith sees that Muhammad is interceding and putting the people in heaven, according to their principles, right? So Mr. Smith goes to Muhammad and says, please intercede on my behalf, I want to go to heaven. So Muhammad says, who are you? He says, I'm Mr. Smith, I'm a good man. So the question is, how does Muhammad, we ask them, how will Muhammad know that Mr. Smith is a good man who deserves to go to heaven? They say, well, God will tell him. So So Muhammad will say, God, is Mr. Smith good enough to go to heaven? And God will say, yes. So Muhammad will say, okay, put him in heaven.
Yeah.
Isn't this what intercession is? I mean, so what did he do? I mean, what did Muhammad do? So what they did was they made God Muhammad's secretary. Subhanallah. God be glorified. Can you see the blasphemy? They say, does Muhammad know all the people who are good and all the people who deserve to go to heaven?
Yes.
Suppose I go to him, to Muhammad, and I say, please intercede on my behalf. I'm a good believer. I used to pray 5 times a day, and I believe the Quran alone. And I need to go to heaven. They say, how will he know? Does he know me? I say, who are you? I say, I'm Rashad. And they say, so according to them, he will ask God, is Rashad, does he deserve to go to heaven? God will say, yes. So what is Muhammad doing then? If God already, since God already knows, what is, you can see. So, they're setting up rivals with God. This intercession business. It's like God's intercession also. Honey, go sit with daddy, honey. This is the absurdity of idolatry. This is why it is absurd. And why it is blasphemous. They don't put it in practice. How will it will happen? And when the people get sick and they write thanks notes to St. Jude, this is setting up a rival with God. Giving power to powerless creatures. 29, indeed the transgressors have followed their own opinions without knowledge. Thus, who can guide those who have been sent astray by God? No one can help them. As you know by now, there's nothing you can do to make them understand. Because God Himself has sent them astray. God sent them astray. How can you guide them? What are you trying to do? Look here, there's a great miracle. Can't you see it? What's wrong with you? Well, you know what's wrong with the person. Muhammad gets very upset with those people. Muhammad has the most logical approach to those people who do not follow the Quran alone. So, tells you the Quran is fully detailed. So why do you need anything else? It tells you God bears witness, La ilaha illallah. Why do you have to add something else? But it's because God sent them astray. They are prevented.
But they made the choice first though.
Yes, of course.
They decided to go straight, so God says, alright, if you're committed down this road, go.
Again, it's the two key words, نُوَلِّهِ مَتَوَلَّ. God turns everybody in the direction He chose. In other words, there are several directions, right? And we make the decision, this is the direction I want, and God will help us in this direction. Like I said yesterday, the Pope probably saw very good signs that Mary is the mother of God. Because God helps him in that direction. If he makes that strange statement, he will see signs. Because you see him going around hypnotized and really, you know, believing Mary is the mother of God. He's convinced, you know, he's holy. Your holiness.
Did the person
tell that now? Of course he does. Yeah, this is one of the major doctrines. That
that Mary is the mother of God. And I never forget it because
and who is the brother?
That was the first question my mother-in-law asked me.
Yours was an orphan child.
Yeah. Do you believe in the mother of God?
So
after I finished laughing, by the time I finished laughing, she didn't want me marrying her daughter.
Abu Rushd, can I ask one question relating to number 28?
Well, after Mobel, because she raised her hand first.
Okay.
God
Almighty
shows
us each of us over
and over again, so that we have, you know, a chance to make the choice. And then it says, and when you continue, you reject what I show you, you make that choice, then I force you into the choice. Is that what I... Nuwallihi. This is it. Yeah.
Nuwallihi
matawalla. Nuwallihi means return him. Matawalla means the choice, the direction he chose. Azuba, you're raising
your hand. Yeah, the direction he chose.
The whole issue when Christians say that Jesus is the Son of God. I don't even have to think about saying it like that. Jesus is the Son of God. The rationale that they give is that something must have gone on between God and Mary.
Exactly.
And
yes.
I think that also has to do with the fact that we try to make God so human. We can't
yes.
conceive.
Yeah, they stripped him of his divinity. They made him human.
Human. Yeah.
In fact, speaking of this particular issue, Ahmed Didat told us, he discussed this with somebody in South Africa, and he said, he actually said this, he said, God covered him.
The Christian?
Yeah.
Yes.
The prelate.
Yes, yes. It's so stupid, you know. If you think of it in terms of reproduction, it's like making love to a virus. Would you like to make love to a virus? I mean, it's not even that. They do not value God. They have no. You can see the blasphemy.
That's what he's saying. I mean, he's so omnipotent on the world.
They've turned him. They've stripped him of his divinity. They've made him human. In fact, they did exactly the opposite. They say that he created man in his image. The opposite exactly has happened. They created God in their image.
Okay, with this picture in our mind, just look at the end of Surah 19. Because you'll understand why. 88, page 311, verse 88, the great blasphemy. They said the Most Gracious has begotten His Son. You have uttered a gross blasphemy. The heavens are about to shatter therefrom. The earth is about to tear asunder, and the mountains are about to crumble. Because they invented for the Most Gracious a son. So you can see the grossness of that blasphemy. The mountains are about to crumble, the heavens are about to shatter. Because it's such a stupid blasphemy. Yeah.
But I think the argument when you get back to them is when they talk about the word. You know, God, He spoke the word, He said it, and something happened because He said it.
Yes.
This is the same principle.
Yes.
He said it. These are their own words.
What do you want when you want when you encounter Christians? I'll probably be repeating this for the next few weeks. When you encounter Christians, ask them, where does it say in the Quran that Jesus is God? In the Bible, that Jesus is God? Because there is no such thing. They'll come up with these indirect statements. I am the way, I am the life, I am the truth. Tell them, yes, He may be the way, He may be the life, He may be the truth. But it doesn't say, I am God. What do you say? It's very easy to say, I am the way, I am the life, I am the truth, I am God.
You see,
what I tell them, Rushd,
is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, on every page, He stresses His oneness, that He is the creator, He's the one God. It is the principle that the Quran is all about, the oneness of God. Now, if Jesus is God, then obviously it must be very important. Show me once where He states that He's God.
Right.
Otherwise, exactly. Once. And in fact, nowhere does he say that he's God or the Son of God or worship me. Nowhere does he say that.
Remember the Catholic man who came to join us at the table at the Future Society meeting? And he's a Catholic, and he made the statement Jesus was God. I said, where does it say that in the Bible?
In other words, he's saying that Jesus is God.
Never. Nowhere in the Bible does it say I'm
Most of them don't know, Rashad.
I know.
They don't know that it doesn't say.
Especially Catholics.
Because Catholics are not allowed to read the Bible. Well, now they are, but until a short while ago, they were not allowed to read the Gospel, the Bible. Yeah.
The New Testament.
Even now they discourage that.
The Bible. But essentially, you see, to them they relegate the Old Testament.
Okay, Cecilia is going to say something, but before she says something, what happened to the New York group that was with?
The New York group?
Yes. They left.
Pardon?
No, a part of them left, the rest here.
Yeah, no, I'm not, Farid was by herself. But what happened to her group, Farid? Cecilia's group, Nicole and Gary, how? So why is Cecilia here?
I don't know.
Just walk in and see how she's thinking.
Yeah,
right.
They took the wrong part of the ticket off when she came. They took the return ticket off.
So they think. She was crying. This is the first time she cried when leaving Massachusetts. She's making too short a trip, and she was crying. And God heard her. Actually, they didn't take her wrong ticket in New York. This was all done in retrospect. Retroactive, was a retroactive action. Because when she cried here, I think some angels, God, we have to attribute the action to God. You know, God said, okay, keep her one more day. Be and it is. So they changed the ticket right in her purse.
He extended
her
hair.
Yes, that's what really happened. Okay, Cecilia, what's the question? You like a rascal, you've been sitting in St. Louis somewhere by now.
Yes.
Go ahead.
I just want to go back to what we were reading about the great blasphemy. I think this is sort of passed over.
Yes.
And verse 19, I think it's really important to see how Allah, the projection He gives to let us see how great a blasphemy it is.
Yes.
That the heaven, you know, shatter. I mean, when you think in our minds about the heaven shattering and the mountains crumbling, that it, you know, it's such an awesome, awful thing for the human being to even deal with. I mean, it's like almost destroying the earth. It's almost like destroying the planet, this particular situation.
Yes.
And so it's important for us to, I feel, to sort of destroy this blasphemy at every point that we need it. Because of the way that Allah tells us how bad it is.
Let's look at the next page, Cecilia. Page 312. This is the very next surah. It says, Taha, we did not reveal the Quran to you to cause you any trouble, only to remind the reverent. Now we're going to see the purpose of revealing the Quran. It's a great event. A revelation from the creator of the heavens, the creator of earth and the high heavens. The most gracious, he has assumed all authority. To him belongs everything in the heavens and the earth, and everything between them, and everything beneath the ground. This is not the one. 18 was the surah before. Let's make a simple mix-up. Let's go to 18, the surah before. I thought it was the surah right after. That was beautiful, though. MashaAllah.
Give praises to God.
Yes, alhamdulillah. Okay, surah 18, not 20. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Praise God who revealed to His servant this scripture and made it flawless. A perfect scripture, why? To warn of severe retribution from Him and to deliver good news to the believers who lead a righteous life, that they have earned the beautiful recompense wherein they abide forever, and to warn those who said God has begotten His Son. It is one of the main objectives of the Quran. So it is a major issue, it's a major, major issue. And the destruction of one of Satan's biggest blasphemies by which he recruits his constituents. Somehow we have a very interesting discussion that we never finish the page we opened. Let's take a break. Just general.
I take this ladies to the
airport. What is the next flight?
3 o'clock.
5 plus 3.
Well, then 3 o'clock, this is the time.
Yes, this is the time. You might be staying longer.
Well, if you, unless you get to the airport from...
For those who didn't hear the story yet, two crazy people went to the counter this morning in the airport and told and told the employees at the counter, we'd like to fly to California. And the airline people said, we're very sorry, with a sad face and a serious face, we're sorry this flight is cancelled today because it's Labor Day. And these two crazy people cheered up and said, really? The airline employees are used to fight. They were ready to fight, you know. Because the people usually get upset. And the people are apologizing. We're sorry the flight is cancelled. And they're waiting for the reaction and to be defensive about it. And then they also saw this Japanese looking girl utter two Arabic words. Alhamdulillah.
No, obviously, something's wrong.
Right.
Good one.
The airline people are still talking to themselves, you know.
So as you see, this is a very long number. We're just making one number that includes every single verse in the whole Quran. This long number consists of how many digits? Each one of these is called a digit. This is a digit, this is a digit, this is a digit. So the number of digits is 12,692, which is a multiple of 19. The number of digits that include the number of every verse in the Quran preceded by the number of verses in every surah. And the long number itself is also a multiple of 19. Okay, this is the miracle that we have there on the wall. So,
that's 12,000.
There are many other.
346, right?
Pardon?
This number, 12,000, is exactly twice the number of ayahs in the Quran.
Yes.
Except we have the number of verses in every surah.
No, I'm saying that the 12,000 number, 12,006.
It is?
Divided by 2.
6346.
Wow.
Yeah, that's exactly twice.
Wow.
Okay.
That's another piece of information. Okay. Now, this is the first surah in the Quran, consists of 7 verses. This is every verse in the Quran. And the verse number 1 in surah number 1 says Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And then we come here, we finish the last verse, which is ends with the Waladdalin. Then we go to surah number 2, which consists of 286 verses, and then Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. But Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim doesn't have a number, does it?
It's a zero.
So Brother Ali Fazli suggested to Abdullah and myself and some other people that you put a zero here for the Bismillah. And every time we come across the Bismillah Rahman Rahim, we put a zero for it. So you can see that the number of digits increases, and we have a totally new number. When you come to surah number 9, there's no Bismillah. So you put the number of the surah. You also include the number of the surah. So you put the number of the surah into surah number 1. You put the total number of verses. You put the number of every verse. And when you find the Bismillah, you put a zero for it. So, when you come to Surah 9, there is no Bismillah. So, you put the number of the Surah, which is 9, put the number of verses, which is 127, without the two false statements. Then, instead of putting a zero, there is no Bismillah, right? You know that, in Surah 9. You put 1, 2, 3, and so on, to 127. Then, you come to the next Surah, which is Surah number 10, put the number of verses in it, which is 120, I believe. 111?
Well, first you put 0, huh?
106? Let's say 106. And then Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, which is 0. That's the first verse, second verse, and so on, to 106. But Surah number 9 does not have the 0, because there's no Bismillah. She's crying. The new number is 13,038 digits, and it's also a matter of 19. If you put the 0 here, there's no basmala, so if you
put a zero here, the whole thing is destroyed. It's not about to maintain anymore. That's how sensitive it is. So let's collectively fall prostrate before God, give him the Qibla, and thank him for this prayer. So we thank God for this tremendous gift.
Wow.
What is this 6346?
It's the total number of words, right?
The whole.
Including the
Lisa, come out of my mind. This is an occasion to be happy, right?
She is happy, huh?
Yes.
One thing
you need to ask is, if you take chapter 9 and 1, this number is
deleted.
Is it again? Yes. Chapter 9.
Yes. 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 I mean, what? The world, you think the world tomorrow will be Muslims, all of them will be Quranists tomorrow. But, you know, God is giving a chance for the elite of the elite to discover it. You think it's coincidence for you guys to be here at this time to witness this?
No.
No coincidence. This guy, for example, is not supposed to be here. It's against the law for him to be here.
What law? What law?
The human law.
Ah, that's no law.
Rashad, somebody unspecified soul suggested
we only
that the 12,692 agents itself is also proof that there are two false verses, right? And when you take 2 and 6346, it comes to that. The 2 emphasizes the 2 false verses.
Well,
talking about the digits.
Coming.
Which one you talk about?
Your information.
12,692. Okay.
It's 2 multiplied by 6346, right? This is the total number of verses in Quran.
Okay.
It's 2 times, and the 2
are the 2 false
verses. So that highlight is 2 times, you know, the 2 comes out.
Take out the 2.
Because that 12,692 proves that the 2 verses are not in there.
Okay.
You have, if you have the 2 verses in there, it's 6,348.
Yeah, exactly.
Take out 2, you have 6,346. Now put it under and see how many verses there are, and you get 12,692.
I suggest that we nominate a committee. To put the miracles in the database.
Yes. Perus.
I suggest that we nominate a committee consisting of maybe 2 people, yourself and anybody else who is an expert.
Yes.
At least.
Yeah. The next one, database.
To create a database for the miracles.
Yes. It's getting out of hand.
It is out of hand. I mean, it's getting out of hand. Can you tell me how many discoveries there are so far?
No, I don't know how. We're losing track.
We're losing track.
It's utterly overwhelming.
And the only way you can keep track of it is in a database of some sort.
Abdullah, you want to print out all the discoveries? You got them all written down somewhere, what all the discoveries are?
No.
Oh, yeah, all the ones that I discovered in the computer.
There are so many profound miracles that are now swept out of the carpet or something, you know, because they became less. I'm afraid to describe them as less important or what, but it's overwhelming. It's a matter of our own capacity to absorb it.
No, but you see, Rashad, it's your posterity.
Yeah.
We must create a.
I think we'll have to.
Yeah, we'll
and being unable to give it to the whole world on national TV, for example, CBS Evening News, which I was fantasizing Douglas broadcasted. Listen, the CBS Evening News. An overwhelming miracle is in the world, you say. But it would have been frustrating if it were not for God's deliberate planning, which is actually a blessing for the special individuals who are to witness this miracle first. God does this for a purpose. And also to give a chance to the people of the lowest pit of hell to oppose it and fight it. Because I'm making them aware of it. We have a certain mailing list, including the top Islamist combatants around the world. And this information goes to them
as it is discovered.
And it will disturb the disbelievers.
Yes. It has been disturbed.
And it will convince the Christians and the Jews.
They're completely silent about it.
It will strengthen our faith.
And
it will remove all traces of doubt from the heart of the Christians.
And then the time will come.
Jews as well as the believers, God will expose those who harbor
the whole world. It's inevitable.
The only thing is that I pray to God that be in my lifetime.
Inshallah. I'd like to see it. Inshallah, this is my life. Inshallah, I've been here a long time.
You never know.
A warning.
It is very soon.
A warning to the human race. A warning to the human race.
Yes, things are going very fast. You know, I really think it's going to happen maybe in the next couple of months. And the trigger will be this translation.
Is this information from yourself or from God?
It's, I think it's both. Because the sample that we've seen is the Salman Rushdie affair. Here's a book that's sitting on the shelf collecting dust. And all of a sudden it is headline in all newspapers, radio, TV, for a month in every country of the world. So God is giving us a sample as what He can do to promote a book.
Now, that's
Salman Rushdie.
For those among you
now,
who wish to...
There is something else that happened in front of you, Ismail, in Toulouse, in Vancouver, where they tried to accuse me of tampering with the Quran. Do you remember? They said Rashad Khalifa tampered with the Quran and he wrote the Noon.
Yeah, but they admitted.
And the person who saved my neck at that time, ironically, was Sheikh bin Baz's assistant, the second man in Saudi Arabia's Islamic era. He told them, no, there are many Qur'ans written like this, and they were ready to kill me. Right? You remember?
Yeah. Just shut them up.
So, this translation coming out without their two favorite verses. I have to interrupt here and interject the fact that when I went to Egypt, and the only person who made it in Egypt is my nephew, who will be a senior in college next year, Sharif. I took him with me to the Friday prayer, and the only verses they recited in the Friday prayer was the two false statements.
No.
Yes. And then my brother Atif went to Egypt, and of course, and I told Sharif, my nephew, to stick with Atif and get all the information. So he did. Went with him to the Friday prayer in another town, which happened to be my birthplace. And they recited the same two false.
No.
These are the favorite verses. They are totally in Satan's hand. These are Satan's verses, and they are absolutely. Where is Ahmed Rayyan?
Yeah.
Where is Ahmed Rayyan? And I was right behind him, and his favorite statements were what when he came in from these two false statements. This is the way we grew up.
Rashad.
That's what your favorite statement,
right? Yeah, at least once,
Rashad. I'd break behind him and he'd ask
What did Mr. Bumbaz say about you? What did he do? What is he thinking about you?
He thinks I should be killed as soon as possible.
Bumbaz?
Yes. And then he has to kill me first.
Sheikh Bumbaz is the supreme judge.
Bumbaz is a lying son of a bitch.
Yes. He's the supreme, did you know that? He's the supreme judge of Saudi Arabia.
My God.
And he's already issued the fatwa that they should be killed as soon as possible.
Yeah, so.
Let me finish this.
Are you going to make a stupid statement of offering a prize and give you more publicity?
I wish.
Yes. But I will, yes. But of course, Saudi Arabia is much richer than Khomeini. So. Khomeini was in the middle of war. So I'm going to put $100 million in my head.
No, Rush,
just wait.
Khomeini could
have. This translation will come out without the two favorite verses.
as an authorized image translation. So I'm expecting, from the sign that God gave us from the Salman Rushdie affair, and this coming out, I'm expecting something like that. So the answer to your question is, it is from God and from my own personal thinking.
What does it mean?
It's only a matter of sight. It's not of knowledge.
There is perhaps only one difference which I'd like to submit to you for consideration. People wanted to grab Salman Rushdie's book because it had pornography and whatever, and try and read it.
No, I have no idea what's in it. Could have been a bunch of boring nonsense, but because of the publicity.
It's boring nonsense. If you read it, you won't like it. When you start to read it, you won't like it because it's not clear.
Have you read
the language? It's
I have read it. You know why? I have good friends, and they are joking me with Williams, but I'm a Muslim. And they bought this book, Satanic Verses, and they put it on the table just to offend me. Their house burnt down. Their house burnt down.
And it's true. I want to sum it
a
up
Chinese.
This man, this man that made a program, the Africans, who remember his name, he came to Columbia University.
A Chinese.
He had all information about this Salman Rushdie. The Christians that gave him about 800,000 to make sure that he prints, because he said he knows Salman Rushdie, and his friend is, you know, he know even from the beginning when that book was published in India, what happened. And they asked him, why would you like to print this book again when you know, when you printed it, so many things happened. He said he doesn't care. Yeah, Ali Mazrui. I have the cassette that, you know, he had that seminar because I was there.
Now, I have to remind you of the refutation of the perspective and the article that Adib wrote about Salman Rushdie, because you cannot avoid the connection. I mean, God teaches us the Article 19 organization defending him. The famous authors of this country defending him with a big sign behind it that says nothing but 19. Salman Rushdie being born on the 19th of June. The English name of Salman Rushdie, Rashad Khalifa, the Arabic name Salman Rushdie, Rashad Khalifa, they having the same number of letters. All these are not coincidences. I mean, maybe 2 or 3 or 10 of them are coincidences, but not all of these facts. What is Article 19, this? And June 19, this verse 9?
Salman Rushdie?
Yes.
June
19. What does it
mean? Oh, the address.
The price.
The address that you write to
price?
Was about, it was, I think.
The first 1995,
but that's not as important. But the address that
they had right to was also about 1995. Sorry, would you feel therefore that the Quran translation will be selling like hotcakes, like Rushdie's book?
Right.
Lots of people will find out what this is. And they asked me to go downstairs and check all the books that I want. And surprisingly, I found your translation too. It's dirty, the way they put it. I think they don't want nobody to buy it. And I picked it up and brought it up. They said, why do you want to read this? I want to read it. He said, this man is crazy. I laugh at them. Then I put caution before them. I said, okay, wait. I asked them, why did you say he's crazy? He said, because he said he's messenger. Okay, fine. He said he's a messenger, but he didn't say it's Nabi. He said, yes, but then I said, but what? Wait. First of all, you should read this Quran, this translation. Read it. Then if you see something wrong, you condemn it. You sit down quiet. Maybe you're right. They don't read. They just follow what
they don't
say.
I bet you Khomeini himself didn't read that.
And you know what? And he's selling it very expensive.
This is in a sense of America, what you just said. Because the Quran prophesies that they will call you crazy. Right,
yes.
Ahmed did that. Resents me. A telegram that's all in English except for one word, Kazam. God said, you're going to say that. So everything is in English, but the word that the Quran prophesied, Kazam.
Going further in 74:38, it says that we are all prisoners of the sins. And 39, except those on the right, you say that. On the right, what does
Which verse are you talking about?
74:39.
Oh, 74:39.
Except those on the right.
Yes.
What does it mean?
Receive the record in the right hand of the resurrection.
Well, they are right, being on the right. Mm-hmm. You're saying it. They're on the right.
Yeah, but I don't understand what it means, being on the right.
Are they wrong? Are they wrong or right?
Being right, you mean?
Well, they are on the right. Are they right or wrong?
They must be right.
They are right, but okay. but why did you choose to translate it being, except for those on the right?
This was the Arabic.
That's what the Arabic says, on the right.
Yeah, so it must have another meaning than being, except for those being right.
But they happen to be right also.
Yeah, yes, but this...
From the Quran are always
yes, but this,
right.
This fact that they are right, we are not right, because we are chosen.
We are
being right.
Obviously, chosen.
Okay,
and
it's because you're right.
No, I didn't do it on my own. But it doesn't say so in Arabic.
Whatever it is on your own, the fact is, hopefully you are right.
Yes, I hope so.
Ashabu Yameen, because on the day of judgment, Ashabu Yameen are the ones who are preserved by God for purity and paradise. And Ashabu Shamal, the ones who receive on the record on the left hand, go to hell.
That's also right.
That's right. So these are on the right, they are the ones chosen.
Ashabu Yameen continuously on the right, they are right.
It says here, every soul is.
You missed the connection.
It says here, every soul is trapped by its sin.
Yes.
Except for those on the right.
Yes.
You will make Christine happy.
Knows your ins and outs. He knows your whereabouts. He's watching you. And he's watching me until eternity. Eternity. I know the one. Yes, I do. And there is no doubt. His love is all about. He's watching you, and he's watching me, and he can set us free, set us free. Who are we talking about? Who are we talking about? It's the Creator. There is no one greater. He made everything in